cutting stuff from boards on the bandsaw is pretty easy, but if you want to do any resawing, where you're cutting through a very large depth of wood, on a large chunk of wood, it gets dramatically more difficult. Some people think it's just a matter of how far you can move the blade guides up, but I'll show you some of the physics involved and why it's so hard to resaw. So I made this wooden model of a bandsaw blade to show how it works. And because the wooden blade won't actually cut anything, I'm just using sawdust to pretend to be my board. So as the bandsaw blade moves past the board, each tooth cuts away a little bit of the board and carries away the sawdust. And as long as the board isn't too thick, that works just fine. Now if we have a board that's really, really thick because we're resawing, and we're cutting along with that same blade, what happens is the space between the teeth is just not enough to hold all the sawdust that the teeth cut away. And so things get really clogged up, and we get some of the sawdust ending up next to the blade, and there's just too much in front for them to really cut. So the solution, you would think, would be just cut a little bit slower. But the problem is, as we cut very, very slowly, the teeth need to be really, really pointy for that point of the tooth to still be able to bite into the wood. And as we cut with the saw blade, the tips of the teeth actually become a little bit round. And the slower we feed, if we feed really, really slow, that round actually just kind of rubs against the edge of the wood instead of actually biting into it. So if you want to resaw with a blade with a high tooth count, it has to be really, really sharp. A better solution is to just use a bandsaw blade that has a lot fewer teeth. So here's a blade with half as many teeth, and now for the same amount of engagement for each tooth, we have enough space between the teeth to actually carry away the sawdust. Plus, with only half as many teeth engaging in there, we don't need quite as much power, because again, each tooth needs to have a minimum amount of bite for it to really cut away. Now, as the wood gets really thick, imagine we're cutting through a 30 centimeter or 1 foot thick piece of wood. We still have an awful lot of teeth in the wood, and with each tooth requiring a minimum bite, that ends up being quite a bit of power. But there's more problems than that. As we have a lot of teeth in the wood, each tooth also needs a certain amount of thrust into the wood, so we have to push that board quite hard. And so with a really deep piece of wood, we have a lot of force pushing against the blade like that, and it will want to kind of bend away from the wood, and that in turn causes more problems. So here I've got another model of this. So pretend the strip of cardboard is the blade, and it's being held in place by the upper blade guide and the lower blade guide. And as I push the wood against it, it just tends to, it'll want to move out of the way. And what'll happen is it'll typically buckle sideways in one direction or the other to get out of the way, because we're pushing the wood really hard because we have all these teeth that need to engage at the same time. So as it buckles, it tends to twist sideways because that's the easiest way for it to go like that. And of course, as the blade is twisted sideways, it will really wander. Now the antidote to this is more beam strength in the blade. A wider blade helps, but also just if we pull on this blade from both directions really, really hard, that will prevent that from happening. In fact, the blade tends to buckle once the front edge no longer has tension on it. So we apply tension, and then pushing on here causes tension in the back and compression in the front. And as that compression that we're added from this balances out the tension that we gave the blade to begin with, once there isn't any tension on the front edge anymore, that's when it tends to twist sideways. Now you've probably experienced this insufficient beam strength problem in a hacksaw, because the blade on here is in some ways similar. So if I want to cut through here, if I just apply a light amount of pressure, I'm okay. But if I want to really bear down on this, the blade tends to want to twist sideways and I don't get a straight cut. So it keeps doing this. And if I just increase the tension on the hacksaw, so the blade is really taut, its beam strength goes up a lot, and now it does it a lot less. And let's give it some more tension. And now I've got much better control over that blade because it doesn't want to just buckle over every time I push down on it.
So for intricate work, I would use a narrow blade like that. And this one's got about 10 teeth per inch, or about 2.5 millimeters between the teeth. And for a bit heavier work, there's a blade like this. You can do a little bit of resawing with this blade. It's got about 4 teeth per inch, or about 6 millimeters per tooth. And it's also a bit wider, about 12 millimeters wide. And for resawing, you end up with some of these really heavy blades. And this blade is 2 teeth per inch, or about 12 millimeters per tooth. And it's 3/4 of an inch wide, or about 19 millimeters, and it's also a bit thicker material. Now, a problem with a thicker material is, as you bend it around tight radiuses, that material tends to die from metal fatigue, so you need bigger wheels on the bandsaw as well for using blades like this. This one is just barely okay with a 14-inch bandsaw, or at least I haven't broken it yet running it on my 14-inch saw. I really should use something bigger for a blade this heavy.
So if you want to do resawing and you don't want your blade to drift too much, you need a wide blade and you need to put lots of tension on it so that it has lots of beam strength. It also helps to make the blade really, really sharp. And what's also important is to have lots of power on your saw, because as you have a lot of teeth engaging, that takes a lot of force to run it through. So if you do a lot of, if you really want to do resawing, the solution isn't so much to put a riser block on the little 14-inch bandsaw, because that only makes your blade guides further apart. But in terms of more tension and more power, you just need a bigger saw.